Even one unsolved mystery is too many for the families affected, so it's a relief the loved ones of the victims described below got closure, or, at least, a semblance of closure, this year. Of all the cold cases that heated up in 2018, the arrest of the suspected Golden State killer might have been the biggest coup, but here are other high-profile investigations that yielded answers in recent months. 1. Louise Beatrowitz. Authorities in New York State have identified the skeletal remains of a woman who vanished from her Long Island farming community over 50 years ago. In October 1966, Louise Beatrowitz, 38 at the time, closed her bank account and left town with her then-boyfriend, police officer William P. Bolkin. Beatrowitz's bones were found 2 weeks ago buried under a Long Island home that Bolkin, who died in 1982, owned. A newspaper's expose and documentary spurred renewed interest in her case. The missing persons case was reopened last October after the Suffolk Times published an in-depth report and a documentary about Beatrowitz's disappearance. On Wednesday, a medical examiner identified her remains after taking DNA swabs from her relatives. Local media report. Beatrowitz's daughter, Sandy Blampede, can still recall the last memory she has of her mother, dropping her off at the local school bus when she was 12 years old. "She would never have just left me," Ms. Blampede told the Suffolk Times. "If she was alive somewhere, she would have called and told me so we could be together, but she never called, and no arrest was ever made." The day before Beatrowitz vanished, she withdrew $1,273.80 from her personal bank account and closed it, reports the Suffolk Times. The day after she was last seen, Bolkin resigned from his job as a police officer. He had called in sick for the previous 3 days. Beatrowitz was trapped in an abusive marriage at the time she vanished. According to the newspaper, Bolkin's former wife recently tipped police off that there was a body buried in the basement of his old colonial era home in the town of Southold. Using ground-penetrating radar, Suffolk County detectives found a skeleton buried 7 feet, 2.1 meters, in the dirt floor basement under a 5 inches, 12 centimeters, concrete slab. Sometimes later in life, witnesses do come forward to give us information that maybe at one point they felt compelled not to release, felt threatened, or just out of their conscience come forward, said Suffolk City Chief of Detectives Gerard Gigante at a news conference. It is unclear if a medical examiner will be able to determine Beatrowitz's cause of death, but Ms. Blampede said she believes Bolkin murdered her. "I think he killed her on the last day I saw her," Ms. Blampede told the Times Herald Record. "I gave her a hug and a kiss before I left for school, and I bet that was the day he killed her." 2. Mandy Stingasser. For more than 24 years, North Don Juan, the high school alumna Jennifer Kirivl, wondered if police would ever get enough evidence to arrest the person who murdered her close friend and classmate, Mandy Stingasser. During all that time, Kirivl said she has heard only one name as a potential suspect, Joseph H. Belstadt, the last person to be seen with Stingasser on the night she disappeared in September 1993. "Over all these years, we've always heard that Mandy got into a car with Joe and was never seen again," Kirivl said. "Friends of Mandy have always heard that Joe was the one person that the police were looking at." On Wednesday afternoon, Belstadt, now 43, was arraigned in Niagara County Court on a charge of second-degree murder in connection with Stingasser's death. Related, "When I found out Wednesday that an arrest had been made," writes the news Samantha Christman, a classmate of Stingasser's, "my hands were shaking." Kirivl said she was relieved and thankful to learn of the arrest, which happened Tuesday night outside Belstadt's town of Don Juan, the home. "I was overcome with emotion, very excited and crying at the same time," Kirivl told the Buffalo News on Wednesday. "Hearing about the arrest brought back all the memories from a very sad time in my life." North Donawanda police said Belstadt has been a suspect since the earliest days of the investigation, but over the decades, he repeatedly denied any wrongdoing, Under questioning by detectives and in two interviews with the Buffalo News, police said Stingasser was murdered September 20, 1993, after she accepted a ride from Bellstadt at about 1:30 a.m. After Stingasser had spent a night partying with friends, she was last seen alive getting into his car at 5th Avenue and Oliver Street in North Tonawanda. Her body, bearing heavy wounds to the head and neck, was found 5 weeks later in Bond Lake Park in Lewiston. Bellstadt, employed as a tow truck driver, was arrested by North Tonawanda police Tuesday night outside his town of Tonawanda home a few blocks away from the intersection of Brighton Road and Colvin Boulevard. Although he acknowledged that the case still has to be proven in court, no one was happier about the arrest than retired North Tonawanda Detective Chief Gabriel DiBernardo, who called the Stingasser murder the most frustrating and upsetting case of his more than 35-year career. "For years, I have prayed for this," DiBernardo told the Buffalo News on Wednesday. "Every night, I would pray for my own two daughters and then say a prayer for Mandy. I knew this beautiful little girl. I knew her family. Her father was my friend for 50 years. This is great news. I call it justice for Mandy," said Glenn Gardner, a retired North Tonawanda detective who also worked on the case for years. "Hearing about the arrest was kind of numbing for me. So many of us worked on this case for years. It meant a lot to me because it was a terrible crime that happened in our community, and also because Mandy was a friend of my daughter's in high school." Similar comments came from two other retired detectives who worked on the case, Jack Deardorff and Edward Cincius. Bellstadt pleaded not guilty Wednesday afternoon to the one-count indictment before Niagara County Judge Sarah Sheldon, who set his bail at $250,000 cash bail and scheduled his trial to begin September 10. Bellstadt was arraigned on his 43rd birthday. "This case was always a strong circumstantial evidence case," Niagara County District Attorney Carolyn Nawatashik said in court. "We now have new forensic evidence tying this defendant to this case." She did not disclose what that new evidence was. Watashik said Bellstadt was the last person seen with Stingasser, who entered his car on Oliver Street and North Tonawanda at about 1:20 a.m. "In our opinion, he made up a fictitious story of dropping off the victim at some steps on Oliver Street," Wojtaszek said. She said the person Bellstadt allegedly left the girl with was a composite of some people he knew. Wojtaszek said Bellstadt has no alibi for the time between 1 and 4 a.m. when Stingasser was believed to have been killed. He asked three people to lie for him and make up an alibi that he was in Canada, Wojtaszek said. Some actually did so, but she said they dropped that story when police pressured them. Between 2 and 2:30 a.m., Bellstadt was seen coming back from a car wash, having washed his car inside and out, Wojtaszek said. North Tonawanda Police Captain Thomas Grant said that Bellstadt was arrested at about 6:10 p.m. Tuesday by officers who approached Bellstadt's car as he returned home from work. Wojtaszek said Bellstadt rolled up his windows and locked the car doors until he was told that would make no difference to whether or not he was arrested. Assistant Public Defender Dominic H. Saraceno, who appeared in court with Bellstadt, said Bellstadt received a letter 6 or 7 months ago informing him that the probe was being reopened. If he was going to abscond, he could have absconded then, Saraceno said. He didn't run, he stayed here. Saraceno said he didn't know anything about the new forensic evidence yet, but he doubted that the circumstantial evidence was as good as Wojtaszek claimed. "I think if it were that strong, one of the last two DAs would have decided to charge this case," Saraceno said. "This case was a priority from the moment I took office as district attorney and underscores our commitment to unsolved crimes in Niagara County," Wojtaszek said at a 3 p.m. news conference at the North Tonawanda Police Department. "We leave no one behind." She declined to comment when asked if DNA evidence was instrumental in the arrest. She also declined to say whether Bellstadt has given any statement to police or made any admissions. Wojtaszek said Bellstadt served 2 years in prison for a 1996 third-degree arson conviction, but violated parole twice and didn't complete his sentence until 2004. She said Bellstadt also has a youthful offender case on his record. North Tonawanda police worked on the case for decades under DiBernardo, and later, under Kranz. State police, FBI agents, Niagara County Sheriff's deputies and other agencies have assisted in the probe. Wojtaszek also thanked police from the town of Tonawanda, city of Tonawanda and Amherst for their assistance. Among the current and former police officers in the courtroom for the arraignment was the retired Cincius, 73. I'm very happy that it's come to this conclusion, but it's a difficult time for the family, and also all the investigators that worked on this all these years, Cincius said. This is something they'll never forget. He added, this is just one step. There's still a trial ahead. Retired North Tonawanda High School guidance counselor Mary Jane Clark Wolantarski said rumors about Belstadt's alleged involvement began almost immediately after Stingasser disappeared in 1993. But Clark Wolantarski, who knew both students, never thought she would see the day when Belstadt would be arrested. She recalled a very strange, very intense atmosphere in the school, with students knowing that one of their classmates had been murdered and that another was the prime suspect. The arrest came as a total surprise, even though we'd been hearing for years that he was the suspect, Clark Wolantarski said. We always heard that the police were sure he did it, but couldn't come up with enough evidence. Stingasser's late father, Richard, talked to the news about the case in 2000. I try not to think about it. I know we're never going to get her back. You got to get on with your life, he said. I try to keep it out of my mind, but there are 20 things that happen every day to remind me of her. The memories keep coming back. Belstadt spoke to a news reporter about the investigation in 2000, and again in 2016. During both interviews, he vehemently denied killing Stingasser. I've been through pure hell with this over the years, Belstadt said in 2016. I have a wife. I have young kids now. Was I a screw-up back in the day? Yes, I was, but I never did anything on this order. I didn't do it, he said during an interview in 2000. I'm not the guy they make me out to be. I'm not. 3. Buckskin Girl. A body that was discovered in a ditch along an Ohio roadway 37 years ago has been identified as an Arkansas woman through the use of revolutionary DNA techniques. The victim had been known as the Buckskin Girl because of the distinctive buckskin jacket she was wearing. Her body was found in Troy in 1981. On Wednesday, the Miami County, Ohio Sheriff's office said the body was identified through DNA testing as 21-year-old Marcia King of Arkansas. She died of strangulation and blunt force trauma to the head. Dr. Elizabeth Murray, a forensic anthropologist with Mount St. Joseph University in Cincinnati, said the case involved groundbreaking work through the nonprofit DNA Doe Project to apply genetic genealogy to the identification of unknown persons. This is not your run-of-the-mill DNA solves unidentified person, said Murray, who has worked on over 30 Ohio cold cases, at a press conference Wednesday. I think you'll hear today that this is really some revolutionary and groundbreaking work. Law enforcement had until now been unsuccessful in identifying Buckskin Girl, despite using multiple investigative techniques, Murray said. Investigators who found the slain woman publicized the unique jacket she was found with, hoping someone would recognize it and come forward. To no avail. DNA profiles of the victim had been developed through the Miami Valley Regional Crime Lab in 2001, and through a DNA lab at the University of North Texas in 2009. In 2008, Buckskin Girl became one of the first people entered into the university's National Missing and Unidentified Persons System database, Murray said. Murray said both DNA profiles were uploaded to CODIS, the federal DNA database, with no matches. In 2016, the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children released a new facial image of Buckskin Girl, which was then distributed to the media, but no one who recognized her came forward. Then last year, Murray said she met the founders of the DNA Doe Project at a conference and began working with them. I said, I have the cases, if you have the technology, Murray said. Buckskin Girl was one of those cases. Murray said a private lab was able to develop a DNA profile of the victim using a vial of the victim's blood taken after her murder. That profile was handed off to the DNA Doe Project, which was able to use it to identify a relative of the victim via a public genealogy database, with tools similar to those used by for-profit genealogy companies. The relative gave a sample of their DNA to the Miami Valley Regional Crime Lab. which confirmed the match. The sheriff's office says investigators are now focused on finding her killer. Speaking Wednesday, Miami County Sheriff Steve Lord said he has been in touch with the victim's family, who have been cooperative. Police say King's mother has lived in the same home for the last 37 years and hasn't changed her phone number, in the hopes that her daughter would return. They were hopeful Marcia was going to come home, however they're learning at this state that that's not going to happen, Lord said. Lord appealed to anyone who may have information to come forward. He said police believe King was in Louisville and Pittsburgh in March 1981, the month before her murder. Police say she was never reported as a missing person. He declined to give further information, citing an active homicide investigation. 4. Frank Wesley McAllister, a Shingletown man who said he could no longer live with the guilt regarding his role in a 1993 murder, called up a local TV station wishing to confess. According to officers with the Reading Police Department, he, along with two others, are now under arrest. Brian Keith Hawkins, 44, made a statement to the KRCR news station crew, who then contacted Reading Police Chief Roger Moore about Hawkins' involvement in the murder of 19-year-old Frank Wesley McAllister. McAllister's remains were found in 1994 in Shingletown, near Grace and Nora Lakes. McAllister's 81-year-old grandmother, Avis Rice of Anderson, said Thursday she and her family were taken aback by the arrests after all these years. "It is such a shock to us," she said. Although family members are relieved that the case may have finally been solved, she said, they are also a bit saddened because it has dredged up old memories. She said she and her family had long suspected that Hawkins and the two others arrested were responsible for McAllister's death. Reading Police Captain Eric Wallace said Thursday he contacted McAllister's mother, who lives in Arkansas, to tell her about the arrests. He said she was also relieved to learn that arrests in the cold case have finally been made, adding she had been haunted by her son's death. "She's struggled over the years," he said. Hawkins voluntarily met with Reading police investigators on Tuesday to provide a statement, telling them that he, along with Curtis Dean Culver, 45, and Culver's sister, Shannon Nicole Culver, 41, murdered McAllister by luring him to Shingletown. The three intended to rob McAllister of his money so they could purchase methamphetamine. Once McAllister made it to Shingletown, the three conspired to murder him instead, police said. Hawkins and Curtis Culver stabbed McAllister to death and dumped his body in the woods. Police said the three took off with the money and McAllister's car to Reading. They abandoned the car in the Costco parking lot. Police said McAllister's family reported him missing a short time later, and when investigators discovered his abandoned vehicle full of blood in the Costco parking lot, they suspected foul play. McAllister's remains were found about a year later by a person hiking the Grace and Nora Lakes area. The statement Hawkins gave investigators matched evidence in the case, police said, adding the two others also made incriminating statements after their arrests. Curtis Culver and Shanna Culver were contacted Wednesday in Red Bluff and taken to the Reading Police Department for questioning. The two, along with Hawkins, were arrested and booked into Shasta County Jail for McAllister's homicide. In 1993, the Culvers and Hawkins denied any involvement in his disappearance or knowing McAllister's whereabouts. They were the last to see him alive. Investigators said they've chased numerous leads and examined physical evidence collected in connection to the homicide for the past 24 years. McAllister's father, Doug, who died in October, said in a May 1993 interview with the Record Searchlight that his son was carrying thousands of dollars when he was last seen alive. Family members said at that time that Frank McAllister had been in a car accident in March that year, and the day he was last seen he had received approximately $4,500 for an insurance settlement. Doug McAllister had said he had searched through brush, asked questions, but had come up empty while trying to find what happened to his son. "This is just driving me nuts," he said in the 1993 interview. Police said Frank McAllister was reported missing May 7, 1993, by his girlfriend and that officers found his bloodstained and abandoned car later that same day. In a Facebook post, McAllister's uncle, John McAllister, wrote about the arrests of those allegedly responsible for his nephew's death. "Today, the man that did it confessed. and he and two others will now be brought to justice, he wrote. Unfortunately, he said, his brother, who was certain of those responsible for Frank McAllister's death, died before those arrests were made. Some closure, but the passing of Frank's father, my brother, a couple of months ago, is too little, too late, he wrote. Electronic court records show that Hawkins had a criminal record dating back to 1991 that included arrests for drunken driving, hit and run, burglary, receiving stolen property and corporal injury to a spouse. Curtis Culver has an arrest record in Shasta County that includes possession of a controlled substance, obstruction and the manufacture of weapons. His sister, according to court records, also has a criminal history that includes arrests for possession of a controlled substance and paraphernalia, as well as petty theft and child abuse. Record searchlight archives also show that Shanna Culver was involved in an April 2002 traffic collision that killed a 35-year-old Oakland area man. Philip Lamont Jackson was hit by a pickup driven by Culver, who told police the man was standing in the road. Police said Culver had not been drinking and no citations were issued. Had not. 5. Christy Sue Pina. Monterey County Sheriff Steve Bernal and FBI agents announced a major homicide arrest Monday in a cold case that haunted Salinas for nearly three decades. A Salinas girl, Christy Sue Pina, had just celebrated her 14th birthday when her body was found by field workers in a Castroville farm field. She had been stabbed, strangled, and raped. Bernal said Christy was the victim of a senseless, brutal murder. Bernal said the suspected killer behind the 1990 homicide, Arsenio Archie Pacheco Leyva, slipped away to Mexico, where he'd lived as a fugitive for years. Leyva was also suspected of attempting to kidnap a 12-year-old Salinas girl before Pina was murdered. One FBI agent described Leyva as a predator who hunted innocent children. On Monday, Bernal announced that Leyva was caught and extradited back to Monterey County. KSBW reporter Bianca Beltran was in the courtroom earlier today as Leyva was arraigned. Pina's parents were also in the courtroom, as well as her brother. Leyva sat quietly as he listened to the judge through a Spanish interpreter. KSBW reporter Felix Cortez interviewed Pina's parents in 2006. When they were still clinging on to hope that justice would be found for their daughter. Leyva was found by Mexican police in 2015, but he was able to fight extradition until this month. Mexican authorities agreed to extradite Leyva to Monterey County under the condition that he would only be prosecuted for Pina's murder, and not other crimes he is suspected of committing in Salinas. Bernal said advancements in DNA forensic technology pinpointed Leyva was the killer. DNA found on Pina's body was a match for one in every 300 Hispanics in 1990. Advanced technology revealed that the DNA matched Leyva for one in 3 billion. This was one of the most labor-intensive operations experienced at the Monterey County Sheriff's Office. Bernal said, the Pina murder case was mentioned by Deputy White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders during a White House press conference last year as an example of why so-called sanctuary cities are dangerous. Leyva had entered the U.S. illegally, but he obtained legal status before 1990. Leyva was booked into the Monterey County Jail on May 3, 2018. His bail was set at $5 million. 6. Lyle Stevic. The decedent's body was located in a Quine Altaria motel. He had checked into the motel using the name Lyle Stevic from 1019 S. Progress Avenue, Meridian, Idaho. The address he listed was traced back to a Best Western Ramah Inn. Lyle Stevic is a character in the book You Must Remember This by Joyce Carol Oates, which was published in November 1998. He indicated that he was going to stay a few more days, though he had only paid for one evening. The maid entered the room on September 17, 2001 and found him hanging from the coat rack with his leather belt. He had left money on the nightstand with a note that said for the room. The only personal belongings in his possession was a toothbrush and paste. The man had arrived by bus, possibly one that came from Port Angeles, south, but a bus came up from Aberdeen, northbound, and arrived about the same time. Neither driver was sure if he was on their bus. He arrived with no luggage, and no luggage, clothing, etc. was found in the motel dumpster. During his stay, he received no incoming calls nor made any outgoing ones. His initial room was near the highway and close to a trailer park and was too noisy, so he moved to a room located on the second floor in the center of the motel. He may have come from Canada, as the clerk recalled that he had a slight Canadian accent. The fact he wrote the word suicide on a piece of paper found in the trash leads authorities to believe he wrote the letter home telling someone of his intentions or that he was going to disappear so they aren't looking for him. He may have been dying or suffered from depression, as he had lost a lot of weight, although nothing was found at the autopsy. There were no indications that he ever wore a wedding ring, nor did he have any tan lines. Fingerprints were sent to FBI and RCMP with negative results. He may have traveled throughout the southern United States between 1992 and 2001 as a teenager or young adult. DDP is pleased to announce that our John Doe, known as Lyle Stevick, has finally been identified. The Grays Harbor Sheriff's Office has notified his family and they are now dealing privately with their loss. They have requested that none of their names be made public. We will honor that request. We wish to thank each and every one of our donors who helped fund the DNA testing costs for Lyle. We'd also like to thank those who have put their hearts and souls into giving Lyle his name back. We are sure you are as thrilled as we are that he has been identified. So like you, we share your disappointment that his name must now be withheld. We all want to extend our condolences, support, and compassion to his family. Those who truly care about Lyle can honor him best by respecting his family's wishes for privacy. We can confirm that one of his grandparents did in fact come from Rio Arriba, NM, where many of his DNA cousins' families originated. If there is more we can share at some point, we will do so. Unlike Buckskin Girl, who was solved in 4 hours, Lyle's case has taken hundreds of hours of hard work by a team of nearly 20 skilled and dedicated volunteers. In the end, all the DNA matches, all the trees, and all the research paid off. This took persistence, good solid genealogy, and detective work. Most of all, our success depended on the countless people who had taken direct-to-consumer DNA tests and who had uploaded their results to GEDmatch. They weighed the risks and benefits, and happily the benefits won out. Lyle is a proof of that. Special thanks to Carl Koppelman for sharing his facial reconstruction artwork. 7. The Golden State Killer. The suspected Golden State Killer, who was arrested this week for killing and raping dozens of California residents decades ago, seemed shocked to find police outside his home. According to Sacramento County Sheriff's Department official Paul Belli, Joseph James DeAngelo, a 72-year-old former police officer, was taken into custody on Tuesday at his home in Citrus Heights in Sacramento County, the same county where his alleged crime spree began in 1976. The crimes continued across the state until 1986. DeAngelo lived at the home with family but was home alone when he was arrested, Belli told ABC News. DeAngelo told police he had a roast in the oven, and officers said they could take care of it. Belli said he was placed under arrest without incident. Colleen Fernandez, who lives in DeAngelo's neighborhood, told ABC News, "We walked by that house all the time, but we never saw him. I'm just thankful he got caught," Fernandez said. "It's huge for this community. Even though it was 40 years ago, people still remembered." Fernandez lived in the Sacramento area during the years of the Golden State Killer crime spree, calling it a scary time. "I was just a young woman. It was frightening. You definitely lock your doors and your windows," she said. "You had buddy system. I worked at a restaurant. I made sure somebody walked me to my car." Another neighbor, Robin Brown, noticed the police tape at DeAngelo's home but figured he was getting his driveway repaved. "We've always felt safe in this neighborhood," she said. DeAngelo is believed to have committed 12 murders, at least 50 rapes and multiple home burglaries in the 1970s and 1980s. His alleged reign of terror spanned from the Sacramento area in Northern California down to Orange County in Southern California. Orange County District Attorney Tony Rakaka said Wednesday, "Today, investigators will conduct a methodical, room-by-room search of his home," Belli said. "Authorities have a list of items stolen from victims' homes as well as other items connected to crimes, including weapons. D'Angelo served in the Navy in the 1960s. An Auburn Journal article from 1967 said D'Angelo was a sailor aboard the USS Canberra. D'Angelo was a police officer in Exeter, California, from 1973 to 1976. Officials said, in 1976 he served as a police officer in the city of Auburn until he was fired in 1979, for allegedly stealing a hammer and a can of dog repellent, the Associated Press reported, citing Auburn Journal articles from the time. D'Angelo then spent 27 years working for Save Mart supermarkets at the distribution center in Roseville, near Sacramento, said Victoria Castro, a public affairs manager for Save Mart. He retired last year. None of his actions in the workplace would have led us to suspect any connection to crimes being attributed to him, Castro said in a statement. We are working with the Sacramento County District Attorney's Office on their investigation. Last week, D'Angelo's name came up for the first time in the Golden State Killer investigation, Sacramento District Attorney Anne Marie Schubert said. D'Angelo was then surveilled and DNA from an item police had collected of his was confirmed as a match. He has not yet appeared in court.